For our in-class presentation on life, we decided to use the topic of war, since as humans, war can easily be considered part of life.
The fascinating yet scary chemical knowledge put into developing some of the most lethal and even non-lethal weapons used in war.
We've considered the following weapons, their effects on the human body, both short-term and long, and the chemical reaction behind each of them.
The following weapons we covered are the flashbang, mustard gas, napalm, and the nuclear bomb.
The flashbang, aka stun grenade or concussion grenade, was developed in the 1960s by the British Army's SAS, or Special Air Service. The effectiveness of this non-lethal weapon produces a 170 decibel intense bang sound and an intense blinding flash of light, which not only temporarily blinds the target but also leaves him temporarily disoriented due to the loudness of that bang. This is because the fluid that is located in the semicircular canals of the ear are interrupted. When this fluid moves due to natural body position changes, for example, laying down, the sensory cells communicate to your brain your current body position, allowing you to keep your balance. The disordered benign positional vertigo leaves the person with a similar feeling to if they were stunned from a stun grenade. The chemical reaction that is responsible for this explosion is composed of a mixture of magnesium and aluminum, with an oxidizer like potassium perchlorate or ammonium perchlorate.
Mustard gas, or sulfur mustard, was produced at large scale for the German army in 1916 by the two scientists Hermann Doctrin and William Lommel. It is now regulated by the Chemical Weapons Convention, or CWC. It is a Schedule I gas, meaning that its only use can be during war. It could be deployed in battle via artillery, aerial bombs, or simply sprayed on by warplanes. It is toxic due to the elimination of chloride ions by intramolecular nucleophilic substitution, which forms a sulfonium ion. This very reactive intermediate leads to the alkylation of the guanine nucleotide in DNA, preventing cellular division and a cause in cell death. If cells do not undergo death, they may continue to replicate, leading to cancer. It is not soluble in water, but it is fat soluble, allowing it to absorb through the skin.
Napalm is believed to be first used by the Greeks in its natural form, known as Greek fire. After the natural source of rubber was seized by the Japanese during World War II, Louis Pfizer at the Harvard University developed the first synthetic napalm in 1942. The production of napalm was first entrusted to Nuodex Products, and by the middle of April 1942, they had developed a brown dry powder that was not sticky by itself, but when mixed with gasoline, turned into an extremely sticky and flammable substance. One of Pfizer's colleagues suggested adding phosphorus to the mix, which increased the ability to penetrate deeply into the musculature, where it would continue to burn day after day. From 1965 to 1969, Dow Chemical Company made Napalm B, which was the napalm used in the Vietnam War by America. Quote, "Napalm is the most terrible pain you can imagine," said by a napalm bombing survivor known from a famous Vietnam War photograph. Water boils at 100 degrees Celsius, but napalm generates temperatures of 800 to 1200 degrees Celsius. Although considered a war crime by use on civilians, napalm is not considered a war crime for actual use in war. President Obama signed America's ratification on his first day in office, but then admitted that he would disregard the treaty easily if citizen lives could be saved with its usage. The Mark 77 bomb is napalm's current successor, apparently causing less environmental damage.
The nuclear bomb has come a long way since its initial usage in World War II on the Japanese. The amount of energy produced from an atomic bomb is divided into four categories. 40 to 50% blast energy, 30 to 50% thermal radiation, 5% ionizing radiation, and 5 to 10% residual radiation. The ranges can differ due to the force of the specific bomb used and the environment it is used in, such as windy conditions. The blast energy would tear down whole cities with its intense force, which can reach out to 5.6 kilometers from the impact zone. This is broken down into static overpressure and dynamic pressures. Thermal radiation is caused by visible, infrared, and UV light, which is also responsible for eye injuries if looking at the bomb during its detonation. Ionizing radiation is harmful mainly from the gamma rays emitted from the decay of fission reactions. These rays travel at the speed of light. They are small enough to penetrate our bodies and cause severe cellular damage, such as double bond DNA breaks. Although radiation does decrease as distance from the explosion increases. In fact, larger bombs only increase blast and thermal energy, but not significant ionizing and residual radiation. Residual radiation is caused by neutron radiation, which transmutes the surrounding environment, making it radioactive. When mixed with dust released from the bomb itself, the environment releases the radioactive material, causing radioactive contamination or nuclear fallout.
Run now!